So the first panelist is Professor Giyat Naqshbandi, who actually teaches microfinance at the business school, COGAD. So we are going to start with him and his presentation. So Professor Giyat teaches graduate and undergraduate courses in microfinance, import management, international business, and he spent more than 35 years working in development financing, sovereign wealth funds, and commercial real estate. His research interests include water financing and doing business in the Middle East and North Africa region. Professor Giyat.
Thank you very much. Do I need to use this? Okay, I'll do that. It's really quite an honor to be with you tonight, and thanks for the IDPSA for inviting me to share a few moments with you. Again, as a start, my style always when we talk about panels, I just like to spend a few minutes making some impressive remarks, so you'll get impressed, and then I usually enjoy the Q&A. A couple of quick observations here. I am a practitioner. I am an executive in residence. I spent, more than 30 years. She made it 35, but it's about 32, 33, in financial services, part of which was in microfinance. I spent 12 years of that period in developmental finance, and consequently I came across financing microfinance projects in exciting countries like Mauritania, like Yemen, Egypt. I saw poverty firsthand. So what I'm trying to say that my expertise and my knowledge is not focused on literature and articles. So you have to excuse me if I'm not so conversant with the latest techniques. Because at the end of the day, when we talk about impact, as far as I'm concerned, when we talk about impact in finance, whether the project is going forward or not, that's what I call impact. But anyhow, we will have a chance to talk about a couple of these things. It's my understanding that I have only 5 minutes, which is good. She gave me 12. I discounted that to 5 so I can move forward. But really and truly, when we talk about measuring the impact of microfinance on poverty and alleviation, it is a big topic. And usually in my course, which I introduced at COGAD 7 years ago, to complement what SIS beautiful microfinance course is that I teach microfinance as a business model. So my students would learn how to establish a microfinance operation and how to start from the beginning, how to fund the operation, and so on and so forth. And then the last 7 years, I can testify that I revised the course on a yearly basis simply because the field is evolving so much. And especially in terms of who is funding the operation. So if we want to talk about poverty, I'm still having problems defining what poverty. Are we talking about poverty in the sense that those people who don't have income, which I do sometimes in the summer when I'm not teaching, or is it fluctuations when it comes to there's a drastic state in the family or individual gets sick and consequently his income drops from X to Y? Or I am just a poor soul that I never managed. So this definition is so important and essential. Then when we talk about impact, to my understanding, when we talk about an impact, we are talking about it in terms of before and after. Before and after, it's very easy in developmental projects. When we used to have, for example, a road between point A and point B, I can do that very easily, study the impact. I will figure out what was the cost of transportation, the impact on tires, the consumption of oil, maintenance, and so on, before and after, and then I will study the impact. But what is interesting, that I worked at the Arab Fund for Economic and Social Development, which is an institution like the World Bank, and we were focused on the MENA region, Middle East and North Africa. That what gave me the opportunity to work on 49 projects in development, all the way from Mauritania to Oman. And one day we were working on a project, road project in Mauritania. And as you know, when we talk about these missions, it includes one guy who knows finance, one engineer, one legal, and one economist. And we were arguing the whole trip to Mauritania and back, how we are going to prepare that project to the board of directors, and we were arguing about how to calculate the IRR, the internal rate of return, and we were arguing. Anyhow, long story short, I still remember that day when we walked into the chairman's office and he saw us bunch of kids arguing. He said, listen, wait a minute. Is there a road between Nawadibo and Nouakchott? He said, no, but we are going to build one. He said, is this road is going to help the guys from Nouadhibo to bring the fish to Nouakchott? We said, yes. He said, what the heck you are talking about impact then now? Why you are so concerned about the IRR, whether it is 7% or 9%? I use this example simply to share with you confidentially my feeling about the word impact. And I have been reading for the last 10 years, 12 years, all the analysis and all the research, studying some of the issues, whether there's an impact or no impact. Well, for me, if I don't have money, and if I manage to get a loan, and I can generate some kind of economic activity, and I can feed my wife, and I can send my kids to school, that's an impact. So this is my start. I will start with this. And then when we talk about impact, are we talking about the impact on me as an individual, on my tribe, on my region, on my city, on my country? Because unfortunately, so far as we speak, ladies and gentlemen, you cannot make generalization when it comes to the impact of microfinance worldwide, countrywide, even citywide. You have to be very specific about that particular part of the city or the country by which you are going to measure the impact. So at the end of the day, what is interesting and what is crucial for me at least to understand is that poverty is there, and there are so many ways and means by which we can alleviate that. And I was just reading the latest book, which was, I think, published a couple of weeks ago, 2015, by the World Bank, giving us good news that less and less people are living on the $1.25. And as you know, 30% of these guys, it's about 1.2 billion, people, 30% of those live in India. So in conclusion, while I am looking forward to have a nice conversation about the impact, I have to be very blunt with you that when we talk about impact, we are talking about it from the point of view whether this fund or this money is worthwhile or not. And I'll tell you frankly, as far as I'm concerned, the whole formula of funding microfinance operation changed. We started with donations, and as we speak in 2015, microfinance operations, ladies and gentlemen, is composition of donors, private equity participation, investors like you, banks, investment companies, and so on. And that's what we call in finance, you are talking about cost of funds. And I can assure you, as far as we have microfinance operations and microfinance institutions in the world, and especially in the United States, and these guys, if they are not getting proper return on their investment, they are not going to invest. Citibank is not going to put billions, millions of dollars in microfinance operations. Private equity, they are not going to put the money there if they are not getting proper return. And consequently, if that is the case, then I can assure you the impact is well felt. Again, with my due respect, we might have a couple of great scholars studying the operation and using all these different methods, from quasi-experimental and qualitative studies to social performance measurement and to randomized control trials, and they come up with different results. And what annoys me, to be very blunt with you, is that more and more researchers are coming with these identifiable, very limited studies, and then they will reach the conclusion that microfinance is not providing the proper impact. And consequently, I see that in the eyes of my students, they kind of, shall we drop the course now, or is it still too late? But really and truly, these are very damaging. When a situation, suicide happens in India, the whole world start attacking microfinance. I compare that with what happened to the NBC anchorman Williams in the last 2 days. We always jump and be negative. So let's be positive. Microfinance has great impact. And I have seen that in Mauritania, Yemen, Lebanon, Egypt, and even in Kuwait, and even in Abu Dhabi and other countries, as well as we have it here in the United States. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor. Our next panelist is named Sonia Kelly. She is a fellow at the Center for Financial Inclusion at Axiom, conducting research on financial inclusion with special attention to vulnerable populations. Before that, she worked with Opportunity International on proposal development and donor relations. She is also currently a PhD candidate and adjunct instructor at SIS, conducting research on financial inclusion policy and regulations in low and middle income economies.
I'm afraid I'm actually going to be really annoying to Dr. Naqshbendi because I'm going to talk about randomized control trials. So I apologize in advance. I think that this conversation comes at a really interesting time. I'm trying to find out the best microphone to use. Maybe this one is the best. I think this conversation comes at a really interesting time because just a few weeks ago, there were 6 studies that were released at the American Economic Journal Applied Econometrics, and these 6 studies are a collection of randomized control trials, and it's really interesting to look at the collection of them, not to say that they can be generalized to the whole world, but just to see them side by side, and I hope that I'm not stealing remarks from any of my other panelists. But I will go over them quite quickly. Katie's like, oh,
no.
Okay, great. So I'm just going to use these randomized control trials as a jumping off point and then talk a little bit more about the research that I've done at the Center for Financial Inclusion. But this slide shows the significance, the statistical significance and direction of the correlation between variables in 6 different places. So you see it's Bosnia, Ethiopia, India, Mexico, Mongolia, and Morocco. And then on this vertical, on this column here, this first column, you can see the different things that they measured. So one was credit access, business activity, income, consumption, and social effects. And, you know, I think ultimately all of these studies try to get at poverty in some way, but it's very hard to measure poverty, as Dr. Naqshbandi talked about. So just a few observations here. In all of these markets where this was tested, there was an increase in credit access. And you might think like, oh, well, that's like obviously if you offer microcredit, there's going to be an increase in credit. Like that just is a self-fulfilling prophecy. But it's actually quite interesting because there's a hypothesis that says that when you offer microcredit somewhere, it's going to crowd out other sources in the market. So there are some who say if you offer microcredit, the informal economy is going to shrink, and that might be a bad thing for some of the social systems that are in place. But instead, we actually see that credit access, and this credit access is not just microfinance credit, this is all available credit increases. I think that's really interesting when we think about development as freedom, as Amartya Sen talks about. So if people have more freedom and more places to go for credit when they need it, I think that's actually quite interesting. There was an increase in business activity in most markets. I do think that is a little bit obvious. There was no statistically significant effect on income. This is something that we see quite frequently in these randomized control trials. I would argue that part of that might be the length of time between when microcredit is introduced and when they come back and measure, because I don't know that that is a sufficient amount of time to generate income. Certainly, it's a sufficient amount of time to generate business activity, as you can see here, but possibly not income. Then mixed results on consumption and mostly negligible results on social effects. If we look at these six studies and look at profit versus consumption, we find some really interesting things. I should mention that I didn't come up with these images. These are from a friend of mine that's at the Center for Global Development, so I'm not taking credit for them, but just wanted to talk about them. So what we notice is there is kind of a trade-off between profit and consumption here. And that's something that we see quite frequently, that an increased profit in the business does not always translate into higher income. A lot of people are taking the funds that they are generating in the business and perhaps reinvesting them to continue to grow the business. Oftentimes, microfinance loans are not enough for the business plans that somebody has in place, and a lot of clients complain they're not getting enough money. So this makes sense that there would be a trade-off between profit and consumption, but also perhaps shows a little bit more about how microfinance might not equal poverty alleviation in many of these randomized control trials, because a lot of people are using their microfinance loans for business, and when those profits are reinvested in the business, it doesn't necessarily mean a change in quality of life. So our working, I recognize that this is an example of a really bad slide, like something you should never do if you are giving a PowerPoint presentation. But our working hypothesis at the Center for Financial Inclusion is that it's the environment for microfinance that matters in terms of how effective it is. And I just want to, I don't expect you to be able to read this, but I do want to point out three things and talk about just three of these indicators that we look at in a publication that we produce called the Global Microscope. It's a publication that is done in conjunction with the Economist Intelligence Unit. So today I want to talk about, first, entry and licensing requirements for microfinance institutions. Second, the credit reporting systems for microfinance institutions. And third, some of the market conduct rules that microfinance institutions have to follow. So first, entry and licensing. In short, what are microfinance institutions allowed to do and what will it cost them? There's a huge, huge range of policies and regulations that that microfinance institutions need to follow. It goes anywhere from an institution having to follow the exact same regulations and requirements that a commercial bank has to follow, and those can be quite arduous, to an institution that is given a specialized license. And when we measured this, these entry and licensing requirements, this is what we found. The red scores are places that are not really friendly to microfinance institutions, and then the dark green places are those that have more permissive entry and licensing requirements. And I just want to talk about a couple of them. So first, India. India is a really interesting place. It's where I've done a lot of my fieldwork for my dissertation. But in India, the microfinance institutions are only allowed to offer credit. They're not allowed to take savings. They're not allowed to be a commercial bank. They have been, until the last couple years, mostly unregulated. They've sort of been left alone, and they have strict limitations on the amount of capital that they're allowed to lend out. They do lend to the lowest income client segment, and especially to rural areas, but they're very, very constrained. And the RBI, the Central Bank of India, doesn't issue new banking licenses very frequently. This year they're issuing a few more, but historically the commercial banks in India, both private and public, have been the same for decades. And so that's not a very friendly place for microfinance to operate, because they can't leverage savings and increase the amount of loans they can give. On the other hand, Peru has differentiated licensing requirements for different kinds of institutions. So microfinance institutions can actually become deposit taking. It won't cost them as much money as it would a commercial bank. And of course, they have restrictions on their portfolio size, and they have to stay micro, as we say. They have to stay quite small compared to the commercial bank. But they're allowed to do a lot of the same things the commercial bank can do, just on a smaller scale, and they don't have to keep as much money in reserve to do that. So obviously, in Peru, that makes being a microfinance institution a lot easier. Second, credit reporting systems. In other words, how much information do microfinance institutions have about their clients? Dr. Naqshbendi referred to suicides in India. There was a big crisis a number of years ago where there were a lot of people, or well-publicized number of people in Andhra Pradesh who committed suicide because they had anywhere from like 4 to 6 loans at any one time. And a lot of people blamed the microfinance industry for this and said, like, how can the microfinance industry justify giving a loan to somebody who already has 5 loans? That is just really irresponsible. And yeah, that's irresponsible, but it makes sense in a context where you can't find out the other loans that the customer has. So if a customer comes to the institution and says, I would like a loan, this is my first loan, I don't have any other out, of course, like, that's, you know, you have to take them at their word. But what we find is that in places where there are good credit reporting systems, you can find out information about your customers and you can be a more responsible lender. And so this is, I'm not going to go into detail on case studies, but this is what we found about credit reporting systems. One thing that's really interesting is that you see that in Latin America, there are fairly good credit reporting systems. And I would attribute that to Latin America having a longer, sort of having legacy systems in place. And so similarly to the way that Peru was able to scale down a lot of their requirements for commercial banks, microfinance institutions can also capitalize on the information that's being fed to the credit reporting system already about people. And then finally, how are institutions supposed to treat clients and how are complaints addressed? This, I think, is the most important. At the Center for Financial Inclusion, we house the SMART campaign for client protection, which is an industry-level certification for microfinance institutions to sign on to say that we agree to treat our clients fairly. And again, this is something that really changes the relationship that a client has with the microfinance institution and can have a big effect on the effectiveness of the institution, I would argue. And so this is what we found in terms of market conduct and grievance redressal. Grievance redressal is basically the mechanisms by which a client can complain if something goes wrong. And so if a client feels they've been treated unfairly, in many countries in Latin America, for example, there's a place they can go to complain in the government, and they can say, I was taken advantage of. They didn't tell me about this crazy interest rate. They have kept my they've kept my deposit and haven't released it back to me at the end of the loan cycle. Those kinds of things can be tracked through grievance redressal mechanisms. And there are also, you know, things in market conduct that talk about fair pricing, that talk about what has to be disclosed to the clients themselves. In the DRC, this is really interesting. They have great regulations around market conduct. And my colleague who does research in the DRC can talk a little bit more about this. They have great regulations in the microfinance law about market conduct. And one of the regulations is that all of the rates have to be posted on the internet, which is wonderful, right? Like, everybody could just go to the internet and see how much they have to pay. Well, guess what? Only 2% of the population is connected to the internet. And so when we look at market conduct, it's one thing to put laws in place, but it's another thing to be able to carry them out. So that's sort of our working hypothesis, and this is some of the research we've done. You can find this just by Googling global microscope. And all of these images are actually public, that can be found in our Excel model that we post on the internet. And you can play around with the indicators, which is really fun. So anyway, thanks for having me. This has been great.
Our third panelist is Julia Smith. She's currently the CPO for Pro Microfinance International. In offices in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. She's also a doctoral candidate investigating social networks and financial inclusion with the post-war reconstruction and development at the University of York. Thank you, Sam.
So good evening, everyone, and thank you for that really interesting speech. I hope I don't repeat too many things that you've said. As Jesse mentioned, I'm kind of wearing two hats. One of those is working as processes officer, ensuring the integrity of some of the procedures of our Congolese microfinance program run by Pro Microfinance International. And the other one is as a PhD researcher with the Post-War Reconstruction and Development Unit. So I'll be introducing some of my research along with some of my own personal observations from Pro Microfinance. I want to briefly go over kind of the landscape of some of the financial service providers that you find in contexts such as the DRC, and I would argue in many conflict-affected and even some non-conflict-affected areas, because I think that there's a common misperception that microfinance services, in their mere existence, can be quite impactful, just through their existence. And I want to kind of briefly introduce some of the other actors in this area and compare them with microfinance in pointing out some of the ways that microfinance may actually be providing a different and complementary service to these indigenous institutions, and then also offer some tips on how they can measure their impact and provision potentially for the effect of conflict, which, as we know, should have a negative impact on operations. So, something that you often hear about microfinance is that it's the provision of financial services to the previously unbanked, to the those who don't have access to finance. And I mean, you can logically draw conclusions when you hear statistics like 1% of the population in the DRC has access to a bank account. Yes, 99% of the population don't have access to a bank account, but that doesn't necessarily mean that microfinance services are filling a complete void. I mean, and I want to just put that caveat out there, because for instance, in a survey that we did with about 100 of our clients, around 50% of our clients actually had other savings and were participating in other credit-taking programs. Sometimes they had up to four other accounts. The majority of these were actually local financial cooperatives. Some of these financial cooperatives can often do not, and they're completely unregistered, as well as neighborhood mutualities or liquilindas, which are referred to also in the literature as rotating savings and credit schemes and accumulated savings and credit associations. And then again, which kind of lines up nicely with the national statistic by the African Development Bank, only one person had access to a formal bank account. So, I mean, who are these indigenous players, and why are they important when you want to look at microfinance impact? Because they offer this much needed service, which microfinance also claims to offer. But some of them are often more more local and more time intensive in terms of the amount of activity that their officers donate to the organization. They're often also sometimes posited in the literature as exploitative. If you look at the informal sector, you see often very high rates of interest. But I would also argue that some informal financial mechanisms, such as nonprofit rotating savings and credit associations, will oftentimes take the income that's derived from the interest on any credit that's been given out in the year, and they actually divide it among their own members, or they invest it in something for the group, such as a tent or a community good for their members. So this is a really non-profit, non-exploitative financial product, which I think is sometimes overlooked when you're making the case for microfinance arriving on the scene and producing impact. So what advantages do microfinance institutions offer when you introduce them on a landscape that's already populated somewhat with informal financial mechanisms? Well, they do tend to be more efficient, and I've certainly found that through a small sample. This is a sample of about 17 financial institutions, so there are really only three or four of each type, but you can see that the unregistered ones and the money lender had a portfolio at risk. That means the amount of credit that they had out that should have been paid back by then, but was just kind of out on a limb, was more than 50% of their portfolio. And of course, over time, if your credit portfolio is unsustainable and your portfolio at risk jumps up that high, then you risk losing your impact because you have no more credit to give to your clients. Whereas microfinance institutions, because of their compliance with regulations and harder loan recovery techniques, tend to have much better portfolio at risks, which is quite common sense. So now, if you want to look at the actual impact in terms of like the experience of users, from a very client-oriented perspective, randomized controlled trials, of course, are being talked about as the golden standard for microfinance evaluations. within a conflict-affected zone, though, I want to really emphasize that it's hard to take a control group and compare them with the members of a microfinance institution, because the very reasons why they've joined the microfinance institution may be what is preventing those in the control group from not being eligible for the control group. So what we like to apply in a conflict-affected zone, and you can also apply this in a non-conflict-affected zone, is a cross-sectional impact methodology where you use incoming members compared to long-standing members, so that incoming members or the new incoming members are the control group. Of course, that has some methodological pitfalls, which you can mostly avoid by either trying to interview some dropouts of the older group, or in the newer group, trying to include only those expected to remain with the program for a long time. So in one study, which I've been working on for my PhD research, I have been able to find a statistically significant relationship between the length of membership in a cooperative and the average household expenditures. Oh, seems like you can't really read this. But when you control for the type of occupation that someone has, the amount of savings they entered the program with, and their monthly income, because as Sonia put interestingly, like monthly income wasn't that significant compared to the length of time someone had been in the microfinance institution. But there is a real significant correlation between the length of someone's term with the cooperative and their overall household expenditures on a monthly basis. And of course, this could have its own, mostly, I guess, sample selection bias, in that you can't really account for the length that someone's been in a cooperative for having caused the overall difference in this, but it accounts for a small percentage of it. I'm going to skip through these because I think I'm running out of time. But basically, I mean, the lessons that you can draw for practitioners, I think, when you're trying to design a program with a greater amount of impact in a conflict-affected zone, you can start by looking at the household economic portfolio model, which is developed by the AIMS project, by the SEAT network. And as a conclusion, if you use this model, I would suggest that institutions would do really well to, I mean, taking into consideration that conflict will really affect your household activities and therefore reduce your household flow, which then will negatively affect your ability to repay and receive credits and debts. Institutions will really need to ensure diligent loan recovery practices, regardless of social networks. And by that I mean, institutions should, and I think that this is where the informal institutions really struggle, is that they rely a lot on social networks in order to cover this missing link in the cycle, whereas social networks themselves are facing the same issues. So microfinance institutions need to look for ways at the individual level to enforce contracts which have been knowingly, voluntarily, and consensually entered into. So, I mean, taking collateral which is really proportionate to the size of the loan, instead of taking collateral that's, say, for instance, the property deed to your house, which no microfinance institution wants to do. So really focusing on the client and their own responsibilities. Categorizing businesses and, I mean, having a sense with political analysis of the businesses that will be most affected by conflict, and not really allowing your credit to be extended to those businesses, and deciding on a trigger point for portfolio at risk at which you should stop all new lending operations. I'll stop there because I think I've run out of time, but thank you so much.
Our next panelist is Lisa Stoll. She works at the World Bank Group on the African region under the Center Consultative Group for Assisting the Poor, CGAP team. Before this, she worked for the World Savings Bank Institute in Brussels, where she managed 5 projects with African saving banks, aimed at doubling the number of savings accounts for the poor in Burkina Faso, El Salvador, Indonesia, Kenya, Lesotho, Morocco, South Africa, Tanzania, Uganda, and Vietnam.
So let me move over here, because this is the mic that works. First of all, thanks for coming tonight, everyone. I appreciate, or we all do, I guess, Friday evening. It's special time. Maybe just for my background, so I'm at the moment at CGAP, but in my past life I've also worked on an RCT with the ILO, So I have a small experience on impact, specific impact assessment as well. But I'm going to try and have here a more pragmatic approach and less of a research view, because that's not what I'm doing at the moment. So I'm going to try and sort of look at what CGAP has done and the sort of the research finding we have extracted and communicated, because that's an aspect of our work as well, as to sort of get these findings out there and see what practitioner can do with it. So let me see how I can manage the two at the same time. So why evaluate impact? I want to start with a question. Who do you think is most interested in results of impact findings? Do you think it's donors? Do you think it's financial sector providers? Or is it policymakers or maybe taxpayers? And I think that's a really important question to ask oneself if you look at findings from research. What is going to happen with this in more of a pragmatic way? Who's going to use it? If you think it's financial sector providers, then maybe the impact as such might not be the first thing they look at. Maybe they want to know how, what happened, why, for which specific segment. Impact generally looks at how did the impact happen. But if you look beyond methods like RCTs, you also look at why did it happen, to which specific segments. And then impact research can have a bigger use than just looking at what happened. It can really be used operationally. This leads to sort of also the question is, what is a positive aspect of impact evaluation, and what is sort of more of a negative side of analyzing impact for microfinance? Obviously, you want to establish causality, because you want to be able to prove that your specific microfinance product or your specific microfinance project has had an impact on your clients or your beneficiaries. And you want to optimize the use of funds. If you know that this specific product or this specific project has had an impact, you know you want to invest in that product, or your donor wants to put more money into that project. So there's a big point in saying we need to do impact research for microfinance. But I think initially the impact research started pretty much with RCTs on credit, and the findings were not as positive as most people would have expected. So they really, what was communicated was, oh, microcredit will have a poverty alleviating impact. In the end, it was not that clear. Studies were not that clear. So it's more, I feel now, the vision has moved to how do you optimize actually, how do you create more knowledge, and how, when, and for whom do financial services work? So it's more pragmatic, and also understanding the underlying needs that are reflected in this impact research. So you know more about the needs of a client, and you can develop design-specific products that will meet this need, which is also very operational use. On the kind of downside, to some extent, of investing a lot of money, a lot of effort into evaluating the impact of your product or project in microfinance, is there high cost involved? Especially if you look at RCTs. RCTs generally are very costly. They can cost up to $300,000. It's very good to evaluate impact, but this money could also be a project that creates impact. So it's sort of different, tricky question to ask oneself if you have money, how to use it. Also, findings, as was already mentioned by Sonia, they can't be generalized. You will know what works in Kenya for a specific farmer with microinsurance. You might not be able to apply this to any other country. So it's a challenge there as well. And the last one, also more specifically for RCTs, generally the methodology is analyzing 1 or 2 years. So it's sort of short, medium-term impact. It's not so much on the long run. And you could argue that certain products or projects might only have impact on the longer run. So this has to be factored in either in the methodology, or you might miss some of the impacts, actually, in the end. Now, moving more to, we have publicized a few focus notes at the level of CGAP, sort of extracting broad knowledge on the impact research that was already done in the past, one in 2010 and one last year as well. My colleagues were mostly involved in that, so I'm not going to take credit either, but I'm going to try and summarize very quickly for you. And as said, it's normally those research are specific for a specific context, but I'm going to generalize and just tell you a bit more on the different products, because Sonny has already talked about credit, and so I'm going to be short on that one. But there have also been RCTs and impact evaluations on savings products, payments, mobile banking, and insurance. I'm just going to draw a general picture for you to give you an idea. So on credit, as I said, the findings initially were sort of deceiving, since people were expecting a direct impact on poverty alleviation of credit, microcredit. However, the impact has, the studies where there have been, they found more positive impact was more at the level of businesses and firms than really at the household and welfare level. So, I mean, sort of a positive impact, but not as good as expected initially. On the savings side, so the research that was done on access to savings and the impact of access to savings, findings have been a bit more positive. And they have found sort of direct impacts on household welfare, also on the long run, accumulation of assets and income smoothing. So the ability to react to specific shocks such as illness or loss of your job, so specific income shocks that a household might face. Regarding payments and mobile banking, research has found that it's a way of lowering transaction costs for households and especially allowing them access to remittances, easy access through mobile banking to receiving remittances. So this is kind of the positive impact of having access to mobile payments. Insurance, most of the studies were RCTs and on weather-based index insurance, so very specific, targeted at smallholder farmers. The effect of these insurances have also been, in certain studies, found as positive because farmers were able to manage risks better and therefore invest in more high-yielding crops, invest in fertilizers, more labor, and in the end, this had a positive impact at the household level in terms of more education investments, more consumption in food. However, the question to ask oneself when looking at the impact of a certain product is the aspect that is not looked at is how does uptake and usage, how is uptake and usage of this product? It's good to know a certain product might have an impact, but then you still face the problem of a lot of clients not using, for example, insurance because it's not made in a way that kind of suits them. So I feel this is kind of a challenge to look at as well. And another aspect that was mentioned by an advisor that came to the World Bank from the RBI, they are at the moment doing research. Sort of, it's the opposite thinking. It's not looking at what is the impact of offering a product, but in the context of India with the microfinance crisis, it had the effect of subtracting credit for certain people. So certain people didn't have access to credit anymore. So they are analyzing what did the absence of credit have as an impact on people. I think this is also a very interesting aspect, not only looking at what is the provision of a product have as an impact, but also what happens if you take away access. Beyond these micro findings, let me shortly touch on the meso and macroeconomic level and the impact that enhanced financial inclusion and more financial sector development can have at these two levels. At the meso level, there has been two, I'm thinking specifically of two research studies in India and Mexico, where they have looked at what impact has the extension of branch networks and agent networks in rural areas. And what I have found is that there's an improved local economic activity when they open up these specific agents and branches, and also an increased over level of income in these areas. So positive effects there. On the macroeconomic level, and this is sort of the underpinning of all these global initiatives on increasing access to finance, the G20 commitments, and even the World Bank's commitment to access to finance, is this correlation or even causal correlation that was found between financial sector development and deepening of financial sector and growth and employment. However, what has to, and this is interesting also in terms of Sonia's presentation, this is valid in a context where the institutional framework is there, so where regulation is really good, supervision is strong. Another important factor is the link also between financial sector development and inequality in the country, measured by the Gini index. So research has found that with development of the financial sector, inequality decreases, which is obviously a very positive outcome to find and in favor of increasing access to finance. Finally, financial stability, which is less of a direct link, but via the access to deposits and savings. So in a country where the financial sector is more developed, more people might have access to savings, more people might save, and this would allow a bank to have a deposit backing in case of crisis that they can rely on to manage these specific crises. The final point is on other more indirect benefits. In a country where there's a more developed financial sector, more specifically the payments sector, mobile banking, for example, the government would have a better ability of providing social payments to the population in a way that is more cost effective, because they can basically use those payment mechanisms to do the cash transfers. And finally, more for the private sector. In a country where you have a more developed financial system, more financial innovation might appear like M-Pesa or the like, which would create a way of having more innovative business models and therefore increased economic opportunity for private sector, developing, for example, micro-leasing schemes via mobile or this type of financial innovation. Finally, just a small point on specific, because this was very general from our focus notes, the findings we have in a very general way. Now, specific project where CGAP is either involved or supporting impact evaluations in microfinance. First of all, we have the graduation pilots, and I actually have my colleague in the room who would be able to tell you far more about this than I am, but we had in these graduation pilots, so these are projects that look at the combination between safety nets, livelihood, and microcredit, and the sequencing and how this can lead to the graduation of extremely poor people out of poverty. In all these 10 pilots, an evaluation was done at the same time. 8 of them were RCTs. And the findings were, up to now, IPA was the company doing these, and findings were pretty positive in terms of increased income and increased consumption of these beneficiaries of these pilots. Then we have a Financial Inclusion Research Fund, where we directly fund evaluation research. One is an RCT by IPA, which is similar to the two I mentioned before on expansion of agent networks, this time in Peru. And they're looking at the effects of the expansion of these agent networks and government payments through these agent networks. The research is ongoing, so I can't tell you anything about the findings. I think they will have the same positive findings as the one in India and Mexico, hopefully. Then the last project is the Micro Insurance Center, where an evaluation is taking place, and an RCT will in the future, to understand what the impact is of stress, distraction, and information overload on clients. So what is happening is they're providing a micro insurance product at different stages in the credit application process, and testing how good the knowledge is basically assimilated by the client, depending on how this information is provided and at what stage. And we will also see what this research will provide in terms of findings. And if you're very interested in this subject and you really want to do a deep dive into the recent studies that came out on credit, there's a quite big event that is co-organized by IPA, J-PAL, CGAP, and the World Bank on the 27th of February. So I'm going to do a small publicity for this event. If you're very interested in that topic, come and join us and talk about the impact of credit. Thank you.
Last but not least, we have Catherine Torrington, an alum of SIS. She is currently overseeing Finca's client protection work and is an active member of the Social Performance Task Force. And she also serves on the board of directors for Women Advancing Microfinance International and formerly facilitated the SIP Network Social Performance Working Group.
So, in fact, I am alum, ID 2005. I'll just go ahead and age myself. This building was just sort of in the plan stages, so it's a pleasure to finally be here in person. And an honor to be presenting in front of my SRP advisor, Professor Samar Singh. It's great to see you. So, Finca International is an organization that I've been working with now actually since my time at SIS. I started out as an intern, I moved on to becoming a research fellow, and then have worn many hats over the last several years as staff. So I do provide sort of a general introduction to Finca for you today to sort of get a sense of the practitioner point of view and all of the myriad of things that we're having to think about along with our impact on a day-to-day basis. And then I'll go ahead and wrap up and really sort of focus in on social performance and what the industry is doing and what Finca is doing specifically to be able to evaluate our own outcomes, as we like to say, rather than the term impact, and the social benefits that we seek to deliver to the clients that we work with. With that in mind, FINCA has recently updated our mission and vision statements. With the very large aspiration of alleviating poverty, and I think, you know, when microfinance began in the late 70s and early 80s, through to today, and some of the reason we were perhaps rightly called out for having called ourselves a silver bullet to development, and all of the great impact research and academic interest that I think some of that has since sparked, which we really welcome and appreciate, we continue to hold on to these aspirations. Our objective truly is to alleviate poverty. It's why we wake up every day and do the work that we do, and why our field staff, who work 10 times harder than those of us in DC do, are coming back day after day and continuing to build careers within the field of microfinance. That said, our vision is actually to go much broader than financial services. We fully recognize that there needs to be a variety of services that are made available to help to alleviate poverty. For us, we are aiming to do that in a very scalable and sustainable way through strategic partnerships in areas like water, health, insurance, as well as a few sort of social enterprises of our own, first of which is in the field of energy in Uganda, which is pretty exciting. So, as I said, FINCA began 30 years ago as a small NGO registered here in the States. And now we're working in 23 countries. We have a sizable loan portfolio, and we're serving close to 1 million clients. This to us is impact. This is a reason to continue striving towards that mission, towards that aspiration. That said, we do want as much truth in advertising as possible, and it's sort of a constant push-pull with folks like me who are more on the social performance side and the research arm, and our great marketing and communication staff who really want to spread the good news and the word about the work that we're doing. So always striving to find that right balance when it comes to communications. I'll speak next about where we're working and our growth. So very happy to have a fellow DRC practitioner on the panel. That doesn't happen all that often here in DC. FINCA really strives to work in some of the toughest markets and to be some of the first folks there. So with that in mind, we work in DRC. Currently working in Pakistan. We were one of the first in Afghanistan. And in all of the countries that we work, sort of the recipe for success and I think the reason that we're able to continue to grow and continue to last in all 23 countries is that you know, we really staff it locally. More than 98% of staff are local, really seeking to embed themselves with the needs of the communities that they're serving, and I think through this you're able to provide direct impact and positive social outcomes. I should also point out that we've recently opened up in Nigeria in the south, so continuing that trend of doing what's hardest, but much to the credit of our management team. In Nigeria, since it is a brand new startup for us, we started research actually before going into the market, and we'll be tracking sort of changes in the community over time through a very long-term qualitative study, a word that I don't think we've used perhaps quite enough yet today, so happy to take questions from qualitative researchers in the audience. So our operating structure, we're headquartered here in DC. Here we handle all of the boring stuff and some of the a little tiny basket of what I think is the really sort of sexy, interesting stuff, and that's what I am lucky to be working on. And we have several internships, so ask me about that later. At the regional level, these are really sort of the bridges, as a hub is meant to be, helping to instill best practice, communicate needs and preferences, market trends, consolidating those. So things like channels, agent banking, mobile banking, really sort of develop at that level for us. and then subsidiaries. So these are the 23 countries that we're currently working in, all fairly independent and locally staffed, as I said. So the early days, Finco was started by John Hatch, who is the father of village banking, which is one of the core microfinance methodologies, which at its very core intends to meet the needs of clients. I would argue that that helps to inform and lead to positive social outcomes, but not without true design and intent and really specific policies and procedures in place to ensure that that can happen. And that's something we've really been working towards over the last 12 years, pretty concretely. So happy to speak more about methodology or microfinance specifics, but I'm gonna, in the interest of time, move on. Three major areas of lending that we offer, a group loan, a small group loan, and an individual loan. And then also, as I said, we're moving to diversify and deepen our outreach. So moving beyond credit to offer savings, microinsurance, payments, agency banking, mobile banking, which is a challenge to do across 23 countries. So all of my answers in the Q&A will be fairly country specific. Reducing costs, so seeking to lower interest rates. And again, I think this also speaks to the intent of doing right by the client and providing a very socially responsible approach to how you deliver financial services, which I would argue really distinguishes microfinance from some of the other local lenders in the market, just as our reason for being. Delivery channels, as I mentioned, as well as shared services. And finally, enhancing social outcomes. So social performance management, which I'll jump into in detail in a moment, something we're calling Finca Plus, which is all of the non-financial service delivery, and client protection, which Sonia so elegantly introduced us to earlier. Moving beyond financial services, working very proactively to develop specific services that target the poorest of the poor. I think the aha moment that microfinance had when we were no longer the darling of the development industry finally, after the year of microcredit, et cetera, led us to take a good, hard look internally and work collectively as an industry alongside the academic community to figure out who we were serving, what their current level of standard of living looked like, and how we can continue to move further down market. And so you'll notice, I think, in any microfinance literature that you pick up today, it tends to say the poor and no longer the poorest. And I think that's a significant and positive change in truth in advertising. That said, we really want to learn from some of the great work that CGAP has done, and Brock and others, around developing targeted programs for the poorest. Health and livelihoods and energy, so I'll cover any of those during the questions as interest warrants. But finally, why I'm here today, social performance management. So this is something I've been a part of since 2005 with Finca. It has four sort of practical tenets with us, and then a fifth component, which is very sort of procedural and operational, which is corporate responsibility. But this is, I would say, Finca's response and ties back very closely to a lot of the industry level initiatives around measuring social performance. And this is our answer to not being able to afford to do RCTs on our own on a regular basis across many communities and countries. So what can we do on our own? For us, this means four distinct tools for each of these targeted areas. For our standard of living tool, item one, they're calibrated based off of the World Bank LSMS data, and then it's far shorter than the 800 indicators. It's right around 25, varying by country, and we're using that to track change over time for customers. I think the crux for Finca of pursuing social performance is trying to balance this alongside, you know, maintaining portfolio at risk and all of those sort of competing operational priorities that my colleagues have mentioned, and finding out what that happy sort of medium looks like from a practitioner point of view. For that, we're very thankful we don't have to reinvent the wheel with coming up with industry best practice. For that, we can turn to the Social Performance Task Force, which is a group I've been very active with, and others like the SMART campaign through their client protection certification. So very happy to speak to sort of the industry level or FINCA's sort of specific approach to social performance in Q&A. Thank you.
And we are going to take two rounds. So if you have any questions, just. Hi, my name is Delanti. Thank you very much for being here on the panel. I was wondering whether each of the panelists could talk a little bit about measuring the impact of the social capital that microfinance institutions also bring with it. I noticed that most of the measurements that were mentioned are predominantly related to increase of income levels or the decrease, investments, profits, businesses, and the sorts. But I was wondering, at a very micro client level, what do your organizations do to measure the social impact? Have you seen those having an impact in terms of getting people at the individual level out of poverty, but then also very much the negative aspects, because that's also something with microfinance. I had the fortune to speak to several microfinance candidates in Uganda with BRAC, and one of their biggest things, so we, for microfinance institutions, have a reason why we mostly lend to women, and I understand that completely. But one of the most common questions I kept getting is, how can we include the men? Because excluding them has also been creating problems for these women when they go home. Totally understand why we give it to women, but how do you measure those kinds of very social, very real things that the individual faces? And also if you could specifically talk of the problems that the women face, because I think most institutions do lend to women.
Hi, my name's Eva. I had two questions. One was towards directed towards Catherine. You said that microfinance now in the academic journals, they took out the word the poorest, so they can recognize it's only for the poor. So how do you attract investors to have for the poorest now that the FINCA is going towards that again or now? How do you attract them? Saying, because there's no payoff for them, if that's correct, what I understand. And two, do you see an increase, not just for women, to lending money for women, but for youth as well? How do you target them? Because that's been my focus, and I looked a lot into Kenya, and that was the only one that I could find with the MasterCard Foundation.
Hi, I'm Richard Lenos. I'm a professor in the business school here, and I've written about 12 cases of microfinance, including FINCA Mexico and so on. And so two questions. Number one, given the sort of mixed report here, if you were advising Muhammad Yunus, should he rename his book? And if so, what should it be renamed to? And number two, thinking of it from a management point of view, is the real issue in trying to make these institutions more successful, is it more careful screening of candidates who get the loans, or better composition of the groups, if it's still going to be group lending? Or is it something internal in terms of either who you recruit as staff or the systems and procedures you use to make the management issues?
I think we're going to answer these ones first.
Well, I guess I'll start just to have someone start, I guess. The question of social capital is really interesting. When I came to AU to start the PhD process 5 years ago, I was thinking about looking at social capital and financial inclusion and looking at some of the interplays and how they affect one another. And I'm going to mention three really distinct findings that might get at that a little bit, but there has not been comprehensive research done about social capital and microfinance. One thing that has been found is that the closeness of in-group lending, the closeness of clients matter, but maybe not in the way we think it does. And so there was one researcher, he hasn't published anything yet, he's just finishing his PhD at Oxford, a friend of mine who went out and looked at how close the social networks are that compose the groups and how that affects their closeness later and their repayment rates. And he found that those groups, there was like a happy middle, but those groups that were too close had low repayment rates, and those groups that were too close had low social capital at the end contained within the group, which was really interesting. So there was like this happy middle where you sort of like everybody knew each other and could expect that everybody else should pay. But then there were groups that were too close that may have been family and been like, oh, don't worry about it this week, I got you. But then that sort of falls apart after a while. And so I think that that is a really interesting finding about the interplay between lending and social capital. The second thing I'll mention is that I would say it depends on the product. I was just in India a few months ago talking with an institution that used to rely on only a group lending methodology, and then the group would come together and they would use that as a time to train clients, to increase their financial education, to try to promote financial capability. And they wanted to see whether that was necessary. And so for those clients that had been with the institution for a longer time and had a mobile phone, they decided to do it all by mobile phone. So they did repayments by mobile phone, and then the loan officer would like record a message about financial capability, and the client would receive the message by phone and wouldn't have to meet the group at all. The clients loved this. They thought it was amazing because they didn't have to take 2 hours out of their week to go to a meeting with other people. And they thought it was just like the best thing that they got their loan and they didn't have this extra administrative responsibility every week. But it also meant that they were less close with other people, that they were co-guarantees of one another's loan. And so it required them to have more informal connections if they wanted to continue to have the same kind of peer mechanisms at work to repay the loan. And then finally, I'll just mention that I think it depends on the product. So some microfinance methodologies continue to use the group model, but many of them have moved to a graduated approach where after a certain loan amount, you go and become an individual borrower. And I think for those individual borrowers, there's not the social capital element anymore, and maybe not even the question of the interplay between lending and social capital, except that that individual might not be getting funds from elsewhere. So their relationships would be with the institution itself and maybe not with informal sources around them. But there hasn't been much research done about that.
I will provide a shorthand answers because I'm not paid here, so I have to be very brief.
Muhammad
Yunus, I would suggest to him, which I have known personally, I would suggest to him to call it social business because I'll tell you frankly, when I saw him back in 2009, when I told him about, hey, we have business-oriented microfinance course at Kogod School of Business, he was kind of, he looks down at business. I mean, to him, business is, what is that? It has nothing to do with microfinance. I'm so glad that he became more convinced that in order to sustain the activities of microfinance, you have to have a business brain. The second point, which I think is very important, as you asked, Professor, I think for me, the focus should be on the staff, because in microfinance, we need the financial analyst, we need the marketing person, we need people who can run business. all these nice ideas and what have you, at the end of the day, is not going to attract investors. And it's a beautiful question that you ask. At the end of the day, investors are interested to find out if they are going to get the proper return on their investment, or the microfinance operation cost of funds should be at a level by which they are going to charge an interest rate, which will equate and more than the cost of funds. So consequently, they can satisfy the stakeholders. The stakeholders might be, as I said, private equity firm, a bank, an investment company, and so on. But last but not least, the whole idea here is that we have to dispel lots of misconception. I still hear the vibration that microfinance clients are women. This is not true. It is men and women. That's something very essential to understand and spread the word. Whenever I talk about microfinance, in the minds of the majority of people, oh, that white $100 loan to the poor, which is unfortunate. And I have to tell you frankly that I'm so impressed with the activities, and I follow it on a weekly basis, the activities of CGAP and other institutions, including the financial inclusion, which is doing a wonderful job and to establish the standard in the industry. Thank you.
I'll just speak to the question about the poorest and investors in particular, and I think investors aren't asking MFIs if you serve the poorest. For them, if you serve the poor, and whatever that might look like in whatever country that they're seeking to invest in, that's usually enough for their due diligence. In fact, I think the MFIs in some regards are much farther along than investors in terms of considering social outcomes, why it's important to measure it and report, et cetera. The biggest challenge for MFIs around the poorest is finding funding to be able to do that. I mean, there's not a sustainable model at this point from an operations perspective to be able to serve the poorest. It's really the donor community that you're looking to. Perhaps a handful of angel investors out there in the world will become interested, but right now, you know, they're thinking about other things like health, which is equally important. So.
Maybe just two small comments on the first, your question on what would need to happen at the financial provider level to make it work. I think it's a question about something we are working at a lot as well as in CGAP now is client centricity. So how to get a financial sector provider to really be oriented towards the customer and develop a product that is really suitable. I think the problems with microcredit also arose because those products were not really developed in a way that they were suiting clients' needs, because basically in the end what happened is they were not positive, they didn't have a positive impact on clients. And I think so it's really a thing about looking, not only looking at staff, also look, staff is part of that, but it's really an approach of the whole institution and the business model to get it to be customer-centric. And that's, I think, a challenging thing to do for most institutions. On this point about the social aspect, something we're also working on is looking at the cost to customer. So What is the cost that a customer has to incur when he wants to access financial services? Generally, what you think about is like financial costs, interest rates, transaction costs, very like standard. But I think what is important as well is to look at other aspects, social costs, like the fact that if you want to, normally you're using informal services as a client. You're going to your family, your store, and you're getting store credit. If you're going to use formal financial services, generally, you will not use those informal services anymore, so there's sort of a trade-off. Maybe you lose connections to your community, and I think this is also something maybe financial sector providers are not taking into account fully when they develop a product or when they think about their clients, that there's also this social aspect to consider, and that is quite important, I think, for certain people in terms of looking at usage and take-up of products. It might explain why certain products might not work.
Thank you. So we'll take two questions now. I have another question, but
Hi, my name is Vidya Samrasinghe, and among other things, I teach in the ID program. I have specific questions. Number one is mostly clarification. One is for Sonia. You know, in one of your slides that you showed that there is regulatory mechanisms as far as India is concerned, as the areas that you're working is concerned, was very stringent in India. But the next slide showed that India was doing better in terms of redress, you see. So does that mean that the money that, you know, whatever they invest, that they are doing something right? And I'm not from India, so I'm not very familiar with what's happening there. But it also seems like a little bit of a contradiction in terms of the impact result, you see. So maybe there's a perfectly valid explanation in terms of that. But I was intrigued by these two almost contradictory issues on those slides. And the next question is for Lisa. You see, in terms of impact, I was again intrigued by one of the slides which shows that the Gini coefficient, the inequality, was getting lower. That it is the association between financial institutions and income. I don't know, maybe that is what it is. Or is it specific to a particular area? Because there are so many other intervening variables that can lead to the lessening of inequality, you see. So is this something that you take a few variables and say, this is working? You see, this is just curiosity. And number three question is, with all due respect to you, Professor, I think the micro-enterprises, at least in microcredits, claim to fame started with Yunus Mohammed, and that's maybe the reason why he was so surprised that you talked about business, because to him it was bringing women, to bring women's redress, you see. So the way it has changed is fine. I have no problems with that. But my question is related to some of the things that in terms of impact. If men and women are both recipients of microcredit, do you see a difference in terms of the impact? A gender difference in terms of the impact?
Well, yeah, so I'll start again, if you don't mind. That the question of India is a really interesting one, and I think, well, in my dissertation, India is actually an outlier, which is why I chose it. It's a significant outlier. The first slide on entry and licensing requirements, the entry and licensing requirements are very restrictive, and the capital required to open up a commercial bank is very high. And India has what they call a bank-led model. So there was the nationalization of the banks, obviously, and they try to divert most of the attention in the developing of the financial sector through the banks and not through the microfinance institutions. So the microfinance institutions have a ceiling on how much they can do, and they continue to face restrictive entry requirements in the market. They're not allowed to take deposits, which is a big deal in terms of how much capital they have to have on reserve to lend out. But then that's a great point about grievance redressal and the client protection framework in India. I think it may have been in response to the Andhra Pradesh crisis and the capacity of both institutions and the government to take in complaints from clients dramatically increased. And so even though there is significant restriction to the growth of the microfinance industry, clients now have much more of a voice, and the RBI is doing a much better job about looking at what's happening in the market, how clients are being treated. And in addition to paying more attention to that, they're actually doing something about it. There's always the threat of the RBI closing down an institution. The RBI has also put into place a self-regulatory organization in the microfinance community so that there's peer pressure as well. Microfinance institutions do not like it when other institutions in their same market are exhibiting bad behavior, and there are a lot of pressures now in that respect. So I think in regards to the entrance and licensing requirements, I think that's changing very quickly. The RBI last year put out a call for applications for a new category of banking that they're calling small banks. And I think they received 46 applications from microfinance institutions that wanted to become small banks. There's also a new category called payment banks, and that'll be really interesting when it comes to mobile banking. And so it's a very dynamic market, and I expect that in 5 years there won't be those very restrictive entry and licensing requirements. Thanks.
If I may, for the case of India, as you know, the problem started when Jack goes to a microfinance A, borrow money, then he goes to microfinance B and borrow money and so on and so forth to pay A, and then he will borrow from C to pay B. So the story here is very simple, that they did not have, and they don't have, mechanism by which they can monitor borrowers and see who is borrowing from where. And for the question about who is more prudent in using the fund, absolutely. But all indications that at least that what I know, that women are more prudent and more careful in utilizing the loan that they are getting than men. And we have cases after cases when men, they will go ahead and borrow money. And again, it is the fault of the microfinance. They don't verify what the money is going to be used for. So he will go, either he will get another wife, or he will have some electronics and so on and so forth. So it is the fault of the operation.
So on this question of the link between inequality and financial sector development, so it was this aspect of macroeconomic and the fact that they measured the development of financial sectors in terms of credit per GDP, deposits per GDP, and they looked at the link with the Gini index and found that in countries where the financial sector developed, this was generally linked to a decrease in the Gini index and a less distribution of low, less people having low income. Not very clear.
Thank you very much for coming out tonight. We're very excited to have you. And thank you to our panelists for coming tonight, a Friday night. Thank you so much. A few announcements. Next week, February 27th, our Friday forum will be on the post-MDGs, looking beyond the MDG. And also, for those of us who were not able to be here, you can go to YouTube, Friday Forum SIS, and look at the Ebola panel, and this panel will be up as well. And our social chair also has an announcement.
Hello, I'm Taylor, for those of you I don't know already. I'd like to invite all of you, as well as the speakers, to our happy hour event tonight. It's at the ice skating rink on the National Mall. There's also a cafe, so there's beer, wine, there's some snacks. If you don't feel like skating, don't feel pressured to skate, but please come and join us. And you can always find these events after either every Friday forum or on another Friday. So look for them and come tonight, and I hope to see you all there. Thanks for coming, and thank you again.
Please look at your IDPSA announcements. We are having elections coming up, and if you are interested in joining the board, please do apply. Thank you.
Very good.